Hello friends, welcome back. We are studying Code First Approach in Entity Framework 6. This video will cover the practical implementation of data annotation, which is used to configure the domain classes. In previous video, we saw the theoretical concepts related to data annotation. So this video will cover the practical implementation of data annotation approach for configuring your domain classes. So again, I'm going to take a same case study that we studied while learning the default code first convention. So I'll just explain it in brief. So one program has many students, or you can say many students enroll for a single program. One student has one address, and one program has many subject, and one subject has many program. That's why there is many to many relationship between program and subject. So this is just a class diagram representing the relationship between our classes. While studying default code first convention, we observe that we are unable to establish one-to-one relationship between these classes. So we totally commented out that code. So with the help of data annotation, we can establish this relationship, as well as we have some other options also. So let us see it practically, and let us switch to Visual Studio. So here I'm going to use the same Code First console application that we have created while studying the default Code First convention. So as you can see here, these classes are already ready: program, student, student address, and subject. So I already explained these classes while studying Code First convention approach. So if you are not aware of that part, please watch that video first. Okay. So here what I'm going to do, whatever we cannot do with the code first convention approach, we are going to achieve it with the help of data annotation. So this is our MyDB context class. Okay, so let us start with our program class first. So say I want to give a different name to this program table, because by default what happened, what is going to be my table name? My table name is going to be programs. Say I want to assign something different name. So in that case, which attribute or which data annotation I have to use? I have to use this table annotation, and in the bracket I have to specify the table name. So let us call our table name as course. Okay, so here let me add this namespace. Okay, so this namespace is required: system.componentModel.dataAnnotations.schema. So whenever you are using this table attribute, this data annotation dot schema namespace is required. Now let us switch to next attribute. Now I'm going to switch to validation attribute. Say this is our title property. Okay, for this title property there is going to be one title column, which is going to be of type nvarchar, and size is going to be max, and again that column will be nullable column. Why nullable column? Because string data type is reference type, and according to default code first convention, reference types are what? Nullable type. So here, to make that column not nullable, I have to use this required attribute or required data annotation. Now for this I have to add which namespace? Data annotations namespace. Okay, so this namespace is compulsory whenever you are using required attribute. So this will make my column not null column. Now the next thing is that I want to specify something different name for this particular column, otherwise it will map to what? Title column. I want to give something different name, so for that I have to use the column attribute. And here inside the bracket you have to specify the name of column. So let us say course name. Okay, again there is one more overload of it, where you can specify the order of column and as well as data type of the column. As I said, by default the data type will be nvarchar max. So suppose I want to map it to varchar data type, in that case I can use this type name parameter. So you have to specify it in this way: type name is equal to, and then after the name of a data type in SQL server. Okay, so we have defined this. Again, suppose I want to specify the size, okay, size of my string type of data. So here I can use max length or string length, anything. So here I am using max length and I am specifying the size 50. So due to this, what happened in database, my title column will be mapped as course name, its data type will be varchar, its size will be 50, and due to this required attribute, this is going to be not null column. So I hope you understand this. Okay, now we are going to study the next attribute which I not listed in the previous video, but while studying the code first convention, I told you that primary key columns are auto incremented by default. Okay, but I do not want to be it as an auto incremented. In that case, what I can do, I can use this database generated attribute, and I have to set the database generated options as none. Okay, or otherwise what we can do, this namespace is already included in our application. So I'll just remove this part and I can directly say database generated options dot none. So what it makes, my column will be not auto incremented, or it will be not an identity column. We have to put the value for this column manually. But since this is going to be a primary key, what I have to do, what care I have to take, that value should not get duplicate. Okay, that value should not be a duplicate. So now next what we will do, we'll specify the primary key attribute. So I'm switching to the student class. So here what I did, initially there was a student ID property which is going to represent the primary key property, but here I'm changing the name to roll number. Okay, I want this primary key property name as a roll number, but again, according to default code first convention, this will be not considered as a primary key. So what I have to do, I have to mark it as a primary key, something like this. Okay, so let me keep this K capital, and I need to add the namespace for this, and namespace is going to be system.componentModel.dataAnnotations. Okay, so this will be my primary key. So if you are not following data code first convention, in that case you can use a key attribute for specifying your primary key. In the same way, if you want to make this name column as not null column, you can apply required attribute, you can specify the type name, you can specify the max length and everything. Okay, now one more difficulty we faced while studying data annotation is that we are unable to establish relationship between our student class and student address. Since that relationship is 1-to-1, it is very hard to establish it with default code first convention. But now we can easily set this. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to uncomment this part. Now since we are going to establish the relationship, there should be a navigation property. So in student class, there will be a navigation property representing student address. And since 1-to-1 relationship is there, I'm just saying student address, not I collection of student address. And even in student address also have to uncomment this part. Okay. Now, see here, my student ID is going to be a primary key. Okay. So as I said, now I have to use the key data annotation, right? Just specify the key. And one more thing is that the student ID is act as foreign key also. Okay, because there is a relationship between student and student address. One student has one address, and to establish the relationship between the classes or between the table, we use foreign key. So this is going to be key also. This is going to be a primary key also, as well as foreign key. So to specify the foreign key, what attribute you have to use? You have to use foreign key attribute. But this foreign key attribute accepts one parameter, and which is nothing but a property name of a principal entity. Okay. So what is the principal entity of a student address class? student is a principal entity, and we already defined the navigation property here. So what is my property name? My property name is what? Student. So you have to specify the name of the property, or basically I'll say name of the navigation property. Okay, so now this will act as a primary key also and as well as foreign key also. Okay, now suppose this zip code I do not want to map it as a column. In that case, what I can do? I can say not mapped. So this will be not mapped as a column. This will be available in .NET only. Okay, so we have almost covered all the data annotation. Or one more thing what we can do here, we can define a program ID. We can define a program ID foreign key. So prop int. So actually, while configuring this program class, okay, what name we have given here? Principal entity primary key name is what? ID. But in student class, I want to define it as a program ID. So I can define a different name, but in that case, what I have to do? I have to use foreign key attribute. Okay, foreign key attribute here, and then here I have to specify the property name of principal entity. So what is the property name that we define here? It is program. You just specify it here in double quote, or there is one more alternative, either specifying this foreign key attribute on your property, you can specify this attribute over your navigation property also. So I'll just comment this part. But here you have to use it in different way. So you will specify the foreign key, and now you will specify the name of foreign key property. You will specify the name of what? Foreign key property. Whenever you are applying this attribute to normal property, you specify the name of navigation property. Whereas if you apply this attribute over navigation property, you will specify the name of foreign key property. Okay, so I hope you understand this. So let me add a student address db set property in my MyDB context class also, because we are going to map it in a database. So prop db set student address, and name is going to be student addresses. Okay, and this is going to be what? A virtual property. Currently it is showing an error, but when I build my program, it will not show any error. Yeah, it's working fine. Now the next thing is that I'm not going to use the student db database. Why? Because this database is already present in my local server. Okay, and till now we didn't study how to change the existing database with code first. We just studied how to create totally new database. So definitely I'm going to cover that part, how to change the existing database using code first. But currently we will focus on this configuration part, and later on I will explain how to change the current database using code first approach. So here what will I do? Instead of the student db, I'll say student db underscore annotation. Okay, so this is going to be my database name. Okay, so again my entry program that is having main function is ready, but since we make that program id this column, this particular field as database generated option none, so I have to specify that property also here, because now it is not auto incremented. Okay, so p dot id is equal to say 100. Okay, so that's it, we're done with our code side. Now let us execute our code. So I'm pressing Control F5. So our database is created. Definitely it will take a time if you are creating your database. first time. Now let us verify it in SQL Server. So here you can see our new database, that is StudentDB annotation. This is the previous database that we have created with the help of default code first convention. Now you can see that all the tables are present, course is there, student address is there, students is there, student programs that is created due to many to many relationship, and I have already explained it in default code first convention concept, and last one is subject. Now if you observe here, see my program, my class name was program and I map it to course. Okay, so my table name become course. You can check the column also. So this is my primary key, we didn't change that. So we change the column name with course name, so it also get changed, data type is also get changed, and even it becomes not null. Okay, now let us check the columns of student address. So the student ID is primary key as well as foreign key. We didn't map that zip code. Okay, so here no columns created for that. Even if we check the student, yes, if we check the student table, we specify the roll number as a primary key. We remove that student ID and roll number is our new primary key. Even program ID is also the foreign key added there. Previously it was program underscore ID. Now whatever name we have given, that name get applied here. Okay, so whatever configuration we have done with the help of data annotation, it get reflected here. So you can say whatever that you cannot do with default code first convention, you can do it with data annotation. Okay, and again in my previous video I told you that there are some annotations available that are not covered in this video, but I'll make a separate video for that. I hope you enjoy this video. If you have any doubts or queries, you can definitely write it to me. Thank you for watching.